Hello and thanks once again for taking the time to download and listen to our podcast from CelticUnderground.net. I'm Harry Brady and this is the podcast for the fans of the only British team playing in the Champions League who've actually won the big cup.
To come here to Juventus in our opening game of the Champions League and play like we did, second half was extraordinary. And we've gone to a decision like that there. It's absolutely extraordinary. We were magnificent, coming roaring in there against Juventus. We've spent £100 million and we were fantastic.
Had our usual European scare due to some diddy defending in midweek and got to the point where many of us could hardly breathe and needed to go to the toilet or walk outside or do anything but watch we were suffering. However, that's in the past. We're there. All that matters is we did enough over the two legs to go through marvellous stuff. Marvellous stuff to be playing Champions League football. And so this week, I've not got the new music on because I've got Champions League stuff to play. New music will be back, and if you want your new music on the podcast, it's podcast@celticunderground.net. Anyway, enough of me. Brilliant stuff. There'll be podcast recommendations at the end. I already listened to a couple that people have recommended to me. Again, a couple of people thanking for the recommendations of last week. As I say, podcast recommendations at the end. Also, you may remember that for the 200th Celtic Underground podcast, we did a 3-4 match set of podcasts where we talked about the best Celtic Champions League team. What we did was, if you remember, we broke it up into, we talked about the defenders and goalkeepers in one podcast, midfielders in another, and strikers in the last, and it was only people who had actually played Champions League games for Celtic that we discussed. So not somebody who played in the UEFA Cup, it was only people who played European Champions League football for Celtic. And then we had a vote and everybody voted, and I was all set to say, next time we played in the Champions League, this is what the team is. So we're round about podcast 300 now, and we're back in the Champions League. So we will be doing a podcast at the end of August in time for the first game away to Barcelona, where we will be revealing what you guys all voted for as the ultimate Champions League team. Obviously a bit of a dilemma because Martin started off playing 3-5-2 in the Champions League. And Didier Gat could have been picked as a defender, a midfielder, or a striker, because I think he played in. Anyway, you will get to hear what it was. We'll do a review of that. Anyway, enough of me. I'm going to be chatting with Mr. Jack Lyons, where we talk about the behind the sofa game and then preview our Champions League opponents. So I'm joined now by Jack Lyons. Are you out from behind the sofa, Jack?
Well, just about. Actually, didn't get to see the game live on Tuesday.
You're lucky.
Yeah, I think I tweeted that after the game. I said not quite being able to see the game was maybe a blessing in disguise live at the time, because I did watch it afterwards, but it was done without the nerves and the panic that probably came with watching it at the time.
I don't know if you're the same as me. I am much more nervous watching a game on the telly than real life, because in real life you see the whole game, you see the whole pitch, a ball comes across and you know there's not a guy flying down the right hand side. Whereas on the telly, you can't, because the telly's much closer in, you can't tell if there's a guy out of picture who's suddenly going to pick up that stray ball, or you just get a better sense for it when you're at the game as to how the game's moving.
Yeah, I agree. I definitely struggle more watching games. Watching games in person, you think the ones over the last while that I've watched, and I never really feel nervous in the stadium. Even when, and generally, I find that when I'm in the stadium and other people are nervous, I think to myself, what are you so nervous about?
And also at times in games like Wednesday night, with hindsight, you look back and you think, actually, they never really had a chance in the last 20 minutes. But at the game, or watching on the telly in particular, you're crapping your pants.
Yeah, because, I mean, so the way that it worked for me was that I was busy with other things during the game, but the way that it transpired, I got my phone out and I saw it and it was 81 minutes gone or something, and it was 2-0, and I was like, oh dear, this is not going well. I hadn't really picked up anything. I didn't know that they'd had a penalty early on in the game. I didn't really know how the game was going, and so all I really got was I was able to keep track of the score, and then I got the comments that people were saying after the game about how they thought it went, and I thought that I could tell when I watched the game back that there were certain things that I saw differently, and I think it was that was just because I was watching it without the moment of panic that everybody else had.
Yeah, you know that when they are playing, you know, when they play the ball out wide to a guy and he's about to put the cross in, well, you know that no matter what comes of that, the ball's not going to go in the back of the net.
Yeah.
Whereas in the game, you're sitting there thinking, he's closing down, don't, and the ball's in there.
yeah. So that was, I did say that on Twitter. I think I said, you know, Not being able to see the game tonight was maybe more of a blessing than I'd realised beforehand.
The other aspect, for me, I tweeted this, that at about 80 minutes I thought, I can't put up with this anymore. And I think it was because there's been such a building of momentum under Brendan. It's getting better. You're feeling more confident, you know, gets to the point where St. Johnson scoring two goals, you're not surprised that we scored a fourth to make it comfortable. You're starting to get to the mentality nobody's wanted to say it yet, but you're standing against the mentality we started to get under Martin O'Neill of, it's okay, Martin will be able to fix this. It's okay, Brendan will fix it.
Yeah.
You're just so wary that if we blew it, it would have put such a downer on the club, winning the home leg 5-2.
And I think when you were talking about the momentum there, and as much as it's maybe not exactly the same in regards to the manager, but that's what we had at this stage last year. We are up to, and then for the first half of that Malmo tie, everything seemed to be going well, because the second half of the first season under Ronnie Dyler was huge improvements. We won the double. There was the tie against Inter Milan that we did well in. We got through the ties. We looked good. Mm-hmm. And then that last game, it was just like a shock to the system, because you're just thinking it's the natural order of things. We're building up. And then that was the final hurdle, and that's where we fell. And it was that same kind of thing where it wasn't just missing out in the Champions League. It was missing out in the Champions League when we so expected.
Yeah, and
we wouldn't.
And that's what was getting me so uptight. And 84th minute and so many seconds, however many, I thought, I've had enough of this. I need to go out. And I went and got my shoes. And I think a Celtic player had gone down with cramp. They were holding his leg up and pushing his foot like they do with cramp. And see, I went and got my shoes, put my shoes on, and then put the game off. And it was 87 minutes in like 40-odd seconds. And as I was doing that, I was thinking, we've actually managed to fart away 3 minutes of nothing here. That's good. That's what teams who win ties do. But the thing is, I've not experienced a Champions League game that's not had 4 minutes of injury time in the second half. And you might go, oh, how do you know? It's one of these things where you start to notice it. You go, I'm sure it's always 4 minutes of injury time. And then from that point onwards, you're always thinking, it'll be 4 minutes of injury time, and it's 4 minutes of injury time.
Yeah, so the penny's dropped when someone points it out.
Yeah, so I then thought, right, okay. At the 84 minutes, I thought, right, okay, by the time I put my shoes on, it'll be 85, 86. Add on the 4 minutes of injury time. It's roughly 10 minutes. I'm just going to go out for a walk with my phone, switch my phone off, and walk for 10 minutes. I've got to get out of here. And then I can switch my phone on and see. A couple of things that got me about that is the adrenaline must be running so much that wherever I walked to after 10 minutes, it actually took me 20 minutes to walk home. I must have been walking at twice the speed there as I did coming back. Secondly, I take the train to games. I passed 3 guys who I recognise as going to Celtic games on the same train as me, out walking their dogs. One of them obviously recognised me and smiled and shook his head. So patently they were doing the same thing. And then I switched my phone on, and obviously I was rather pleased.
Yeah, because I think the feeling was a bit the same for me. I was at another game for the team that I'm coaching with, and so we got, you know, we were quite a bit ahead in the game, and that's when the game was still going on, but I was like, right, I've checked my phone, because
you're coaching Borussia Munchengladbach.
Oh, that's really like the penny drop. Yeah, so it got to a point where we were comfortable in that game, and I was like, right, I'll have a look at the Celtic game. And just so happened that the boys that were off at the time, 3 Celtic fans, so they were like, oh, what's the score? And I was like, oh, it's such and such, and they were like, oh, God. So we were sitting, and then just at the game, and so you've got the coaches and the players that are off all on one side, and the pitch, and the supporters are all the parents are all on the other side of the pitch, and all at the same moment, you just heard, like, a gathering of people were just going, ah! And I was like, oh yeah, that must be the game finished.
You're thinking, I hope they're not all Huns.
And as it transpired, there was 3 dads that had the game on their phone watching it live. They weren't even watching their boys. They were just watching the Celtic game live at the time. But it was a hard 10 minutes, and even at the side, we were all like, oh God, I can't deal with this pressure. Why can they not just make it easy? Because now, one of the other coaches I coach with supports another Glasgow team, and it's not Partick Thistle. And before the game, he was like, you know, just sort of saying, oh, you know, you'll lose 4-1 or whatever tonight. And I said, don't you worry, we're already through. And then when I told him it was 2-0, he was like, what was that you were saying before the game? And I was like, I know, I need to learn to be quiet sometimes. But yeah, it was just a huge, oh, a huge relief when I heard the score.
So did you watch the highlights or the whole game again?
I watched the whole game.
Poof. You're a brave soul. Well, you knew the score, so it's not a brave soul thing.
No.
See the Dembele. I thought that I couldn't believe that was not in. Dembele's shot that just curled round. Because the camera's right behind it, and all the way you're thinking, this is going to hit the post on the inside and roll round the side net and into the back of the net.
Yeah. It was, and I noticed when I watched the game back that Brendan Rodgers did the same thing in both games, where with the Dembele shot and at the end of the home tie, the Sinclair chance. And in both of those instances, he began to celebrate.
Yeah.
And then it happened, like it cut to the camera, and you can see him start to run along the touchline, puts his hands up in the air, and then hands go on top of the head.
Because I was also thinking, I kept thinking about that Scott Sinclair chance right at the end to made it 6-2. Because as the day went on Tuesday, I just kept thinking, the way we play in Europe, it's the nerves of the team. No matter what, they know. They're going into this knowing, this is it for our club. This is the game. And the nerves of the team, you've seen it before, different managers, different players going into that game. And I thought, I can see a situation where they score in the first half to make it 1-0. We go into this game with the players thinking the most important thing is not to leave space behind and lose a goal because we've won the game already. A bit like when we'd beaten Ajax 3-1 away under Martin O'Neill. I always felt the problem the players had was at Celtic Park, they just didn't know what to do.
Yeah, it's that odd mindset.
They may be told one thing by the manager, but in their heads they're thinking something else.
Yeah, it's that odd mindset where you know the instinct isn't to attack. And from some perspectives, getting a bad result in the first game is the easiest thing that can happen, because in that second leg you've got a clear mindset. You think back to like the Karagandy game at this stage.
Yeah.
We knew we had to go out and we had to win by 3 goals, and we couldn't really concede.
So the... If we've just, because I want to move on to talking about the group that we've got in. So just very briefly, if we sort of talk about the key moments of Tuesday night. Penalty. Was that a penalty?
No. It wasn't in the box.
No.
And now, yeah, I mean, Gordon at the time, I saw points to the ground, and you can see there's clearly a big ditch where Janko's foot's been. And there's a big bit of turf missing. And he points to that, and it's as clear as day when I saw it. And obviously, again, I'm sitting watching it without any real emotional reaction, which I generally have to do anyway. If I'm going to be writing or speaking about the game or whatever, I generally have to watch it back afterwards because I get caught up in it. But I watched it, and my first thought was, God, that was not a penalty.
So that's
straight
that.
Away.
Then their goal, I think it was Brown had the guy who scored the goal.
Yeah, the corner. Yeah. I suppose that's just one of the... I mean, they were about the same height, so... But, I mean, and this is maybe something I spoke about before the game, and it's not a widespread opinion, but I'm quite a big fan of O'Connell, and when he wasn't in the team, I was quite surprised. And being that kind of thing where that, you know, you want to be right. When they scored that, I thought, if O'Connell was on instead of Janko, someone bigger would have been on him. And that was just a kind of tell myself, oh yeah, you go that one right. But it's hard to be too harsh. Brown's not amazing in the air. I think it's just one of these things that happens. We're not traditionally excellent from defensive set pieces. That's something we've got used to over the last few years.
Now, you're the technical guy here, so my recollection of it is Tierney takes up a position more or less level with the front post inside the 6-yard box. So he's not marking anyone. It's a sort of a zone thing. But he's not on the post, but there's nobody near him. He's just at that area. And then when the guy takes the header, he's making his way back towards goal.
Yeah.
What's the deal with that
That's quite common. So it's just a case of, is a player being able to play a double role? Because he's not necessarily got a man, but he's there for if the ball gets whipped in at the front post, that there's someone there to clear it away instead of it just going through bodies. Because if we're picking up men or zones, then it can easily just pass through if there's no one in that gap. But so that you don't lose a man in the box by putting someone on the post, if that ball goes over the top for a header, then the player is to move back round on at the post. That's the thinking behind it. And you always hear criticism of, oh, there was no guys on the posts there. But the thinking there is we need more guys to win the header. And if we win more headers, then we won't need guys on the post. That's the general thought process.
Well, so that's another question I was going to ask, is growing up, I was a goalkeeper. And it was fairly, there was no thought processes behind it. Your setup was, you went two-thirds of the way back, and you put one guy in the front post, one guy in the back post. And then the other defenders would then, because there was no such thing as schoolboy football, zonal marking or man marking, the other guys then picked up people in the penalty box. Why did teams... I sort of get not having anybody in a post, because one of the problems with sticking people in a post is you're then allowing a guy to stand right in your keeper, because no matter what happens at the corner kick, he can stay right in on goal and stay onside. You know, if the ball's bobbling around, he's onside.
Yeah.
So I can see that's one of the reasons for not having people in post. I never quite get the concept where some teams have a guy on one post, but not on the other post. Maybe I'm a bit old fashioned, but I go posts or no posts. I don't get the one post.
I think it's just I wish there was some kind of clear evidence based approach to this, but it seems to just be each individual coach goes, oh, I'll try this, and then whichever one he feels works for him in his experience, that's what he'll stick with. That applies to guys on posts, man marking, zone marking, some kind of mixture, any kind of approach. There isn't really an evidence-based approach to how to approach corners. It's just, we'll do what I think is kind of best in my opinion. And so one post is kind of halfway between, oh, we need to get more guys in the box and we don't want to leave the goal exposed, or... Yeah, I don't think there's any clear right or wrong way either. I think it's just a case of, we'll do it this way, and if it's executed well, then we defend well from corners, and if it's not executed well, then we don't.
Right, I'm going to then move on to the second goal before I then go back to a general question about stuff. So second goal, Craig Gordon's fault, Janko's fault, or both are fault?
Bit of both, I think. Gordon, for me, my first reaction was Gordon really should be claiming that. It's coming straight towards him and he kind of just stands still for a long time.
Come out. Not wait for the ball to come to you. Come out, take it, set your feet so that no matter what then happens, you're set.
Yeah, or at least when the ball's coming through, make it clear that you're going to take it. But what seemed to happen was Gordon's thinking, I'm going to take this, but he never really lets anyone know. And so Janko's running in thinking, I'm going to have to head this ball away.
Covering the run of the Hapoel.
Yeah, the Hapoel player.
Yep.
He's thinking, I'm going to have to head this ball away, and the two of them basically get to the ball at the same time, or Janko a split second behind Gordon, and then it's a goal. A bit of both. I think it's one of those things where it's just a lack of communication. If one of them at least should be saying, this is mine, and I think it should be the goalkeeper because he's got the clear view, whereas Janko is busy thinking about where's this guy, and the ball's coming straight towards Gordon. It seemed clear to me on the picture, and it's easy to say that when you're not in the game, but it seemed clear to me this is going to him and no one's getting on the end of it. So I thought he should have taken it, personally.
So the next question is more of a sort of a general one. Why are we so crap at set pieces at the back?
I think if I had the answer to that, then maybe I wouldn't be you know, I'd maybe get a job somewhere. But it just seems like...
Do you think it's partly in their heads now? That, you know, I think I used the analogy before, if anybody's into golf or whatever, I can go up to the golf course 5 nights in a row and sink putts from four feet in. But if I go up and play with other people in a meadow, the last 3 or 4 times I've played in anything with other people, I've missed a couple of simple putts. So I now stand over the ball when I'm with other people thinking, don't miss this. Don't miss this. You're always missing this size of putt. Is it? Do you think it's as simple as we now have it in our heads that we have a problem at set pieces?
I mean, that could definitely be a part of it. Obviously, one thing that won't help is the fact that we still haven't had a settled defence for since Van Dijk and Denier, really.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that can't help that. Players, different systems, obviously, within that time frame since Van Dijk and Denier, we've played man marking, zonal marking, a mixture. Obviously, like you were saying about the posts, sometimes we've had guys on the post, sometimes we haven't. We seem to have tried every different method. And so you've got different guys coming in, playing different roles all the time. And I think, as we've discussed before, one of the things about Gordon is that he's not forceful in coming out and taking the ball. So there is a certain amount that maybe comes into dangerous areas that a keeper who's better in that area would deal with. It's just a mixture of those things, I suppose. It's hard to pinpoint any one thing. You can't say it's this player, it's this area, because it's, you know, we've got these issues, different managers, different players, different systems. I think there must be something in the mindset of it, as you pointed out, because I don't believe that we've gone through 14, 15 months of football with probably the best part of 12 to 15 different defenders, and at no point we managed to come across a selection which could defend a set piece.
So, obviously we've signed De Vries. Do you think he's going to replace Gordon in the next few weeks?
I would imagine he would, yeah. Especially with how Rodgers has spoken about him, and obviously the strengths that he's got with regards to the ball at his feet. I think that's quite important to Rodgers' style of play. Rodgers has said that himself. And that's just something that Gordon doesn't really have for me. He's too easily rushed into a long kick or... And I think an important thing is that it's not even necessarily technical ability, because I think if you look at someone like Neuer, who's kind of the framework or the archetypal goalkeeper for playing out from the back, if you compare him to other goalkeepers, then he's not always necessarily a better passer, but he's an intelligent guy. He knows where to put himself to make angles for passes, to position himself to play the next pass like any other player would. Whereas I think most goalkeepers, if they've never played that way, then they've never even considered it. And so they don't know how to position themselves to support the team in that way.
I'm going to show my age here, because when I was playing schoolboy as a goalkeeper, it was before the pass-back rule, right? But I was taught... as a goalkeeper. So the point I'm making is these guys were taught and coached to a much higher standard than me for a longer period of time post passback rule coming in. I was taught when our team were attacking that I should be halfway between the edge of my box and the halfway line, so that if there was a... You didn't have a situation where somebody hoofed the ball up the park and a guy is able to run 30 yards on me. That, you know, if needs be, I was in a position to be able to deal with something like that. Secondly, because you get a better perspective of the game if you're just having a better vision of it. But then that also then came back to, and you, as the ball moved up the park, obviously as soon as the ball came out of their box, you were to move back into your goal. But it then meant you were on the edge of your box. But it then, it was The point I'm making is, it was about you not being a guy who's rooted to your goal line. It was about the fact that you're a guy who, you're in charge of the defensive part of the park, wherever the defensive part of the park is. So if we were defending, the defensive part of the park was inside the penalty box. If we were attacking, the defensive part of the box started at halfway line. It was my job to be able to be in control of that. If I was back on the goal line, I'm not in communication with the key centre-half. Invariably, at schoolboy level, there's one centre-half who's just can head the ball and the stick as mince, and there's another centre-half who's reasonably intelligent. It was where I learned the concept of the spine of the team, because the goalkeeper needed to be intelligent, because you're the one guy in the team who is permanently, as you said about Gordon watching everything, the whole thing about it is, for me, the goalkeeper is the most important person, because he's the only guy in the team who's watching the whole game happen in front of him for the whole match. So he's he's in a better place than anybody else in the park to start to relay information to people about what's going on in the game. But that's about being in control and being out there. And so the one aspect of that then is being in a position to take passes, to assist out your defenders. Because they're going to be closed down from in front of them, so the only free pass they may have on occasion is to me.
Yeah.
And that was before the pass-back rule. I would have thought that would be doubly important post-pass-back rule.
Well, I think we're only really starting to see that now, how important. Teams have really started to go, once the pass-back rule came in, but what would happen was the keeper would make sure he was able to take a pass, but he would kick it long when he got it because he wasn't necessarily comfortable. But over the last sort of 5 years, through guys like Neuer and a number of others, we're seeing how important that is. And obviously it's quite a big thing in the media just now because of the whole Joe Hart situation in Manchester City, and that's ultimately why Guardiola seems to not be playing him, is because he doesn't feel he's got the technical skills on the ball to be a goalkeeper in his system. So you talked about how when you were a goalkeeper, it was about, you had to be higher up the pitch and control that half of the park when your team were attacking, but sometimes it's a case of defending in your own box, taking the ball in your own box, in your own 6-yard box even. And that's something that probably most keepers can do that role high up the pitch when the other team's in, when your team's attacking the opposition half, can do that. But someone like Gordon cannot comfortably take a pass inside his own box under pressure and then play another pass. He's easily forced into a long pass. And I think that skill set is important to Rodgers, as he said.
Here's another thing, again, as my go-to technical guru on this. I have thought this for years. And there was a point where the need for what I'm about to suggest came up. On Tuesday night, the ball came to Brown on the our left, and he's just running, and our team is, it must have been, about 80 minutes or something like that. And so our team's knackered because they've been chasing the ball all night. There's no forward pass for Brown because it's broken out from a set piece that they had, so there's nobody in front of Brown for him to play the ball to, and no Celtic players obviously we're starting to defend deep, and there's no Celtic players making an angle for Brown to make a pass, and all that happens is Brown just runs with the ball until four Hapoel players close him down. He just runs into someone and we lose the ball at the halfway line and it comes straight back. And for years I have thought, why do we not, or all teams not practice, all lesser teams for when you're, or all teams for when you're playing an opposition who's on the front foot and you're in the defensive position, in the scenario we were in. Why do teams not practice, in rugby where teams kick for touch? If you in Brown's position thought, I might run with another 5 yards of this, or I can hook this down the park so that practice actually playing the ball out so that it goes out about 5 yards from the corner flag.
Yeah.
And it just makes them have to track back 30 yards, and it allows us to push we're going to lose the ball anyway because there's nobody in front of him, no angle on. He's absolutely knackered and can hardly run any further with the ball. The, practicing the principle of kicking for touch. The amount of times I've seen it in European football where what Brown did on Tuesday night is a regular occurrence. You know, I've seen us, you know, away from home in the Nou Camp, drawing 0-0, away from home in the San Siro, where we look like we're about to get a result. And you're in that position and you think, just run and have it in your mind, Mr. Player, that when you're about to run out of energy, you know how to put the ball out. I don't understand why teams don't practice that.
Yeah, it seems like that is a perfect example of one of those things that just doesn't happen in football. But if anyone tried it, as soon as someone does try it, everyone will do it because it makes complete sense. But it's just a kind of naivety almost that we won't try and... Because that seems, if you think about it, just on a totally base level, what you're saying is deliberately kick the ball out for their throw-in.
Yeah.
And so people will say, oh, that's a ridiculous idea. But ultimately, it's something that if teams did it, then they would get, like you say, like in the whole purpose of it in rugby is that you get a bit of territory if you're under pressure. Or and they do it in... sure they do it in American football, something similar, where they're getting territory, so we can all push up, and instead of them being on top of us for, even if they've still got the ball, but they're instead of having to break down our defence, you know, 20 yards from our goal, their problem is having to play out from the back.
Yeah, I mean, okay. I know if there's only 2 minutes left in a game, which is the type of occasion when you might be using this principle, they should be able to relatively straightforwardly take a throw in, get it to the keeper who can then launch it long. But if you did it, practiced it well enough, then your system would be, you would set up and you're in a defensive position from the halfway line with two guys who would just belt up the park to make it difficult for them to just quickly throw it to the keeper and boot it up the park. Two guys who just make them have to take 20 seconds longer to play it before they play it up the park. Because it's not just, it's about possession, and it's about, through doing that, you might be able to kill 30 seconds.
Yeah, because instead of getting the ball back on the halfway line and being straight on top of you, they might have to even play two or three passes, and it may be easier than normal for them to get out from the back, but they might still have to play two or three passes, and they've got 100 yards to travel,
yeah,
to go instead of 30, 40, 50 yards. It's one of these things that maybe, I don't know, it's just that thing
that people would say. It's that thing that they start off the book, The Numbers Game. They start talking about the Stoke. You know, what prompts the book is the Stoke long throw.
Yeah.
Where the guy who's less into football says, why don't more teams do that? And the guy who's really into football eventually gets around to saying, because it's just not the done thing.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not right.
That's precisely what it is. It's just, that's not how we've done it. So that's not right. Whereas maybe it's, you know, they've not tried this, but it's just written off as a ridiculous idea. I remember reading something, it was about complete outsiders. And that's what that seems like, that Stoke thing. And you're saying a guy who's not really a football fan, why don't more teams do that? Complete outsiders ask the stupid, simple questions that people who think they know the game don't never ask. Like that question you've just asked.
I don't know. It just seems obvious to me because the amount of times I've seen Celtic players who can virtually not run the length of themselves and they're the last guy up the park and all they do is just run into an opponent and you think, you knew that was going to happen because you've not got enough energy.
You can picture, though, how that conversation would go. You can imagine some young guy or a young coach or, you know, you've got all kinds of analysts and all that now in clubs. You can imagine someone like that saying to a manager, you know, your archetypal British manager, oh, why don't we try this? And they've just got, oh, don't be so ridiculous.
I know it goes against the grain because what you're actually advocating is intentionally giving up possession. But it's about, it's exactly the same as when you're under pressure deliberately giving away a niggly foul just to stop play and allow everybody to reset. It's the same principle of you're resetting play, you're getting yourselves time to position yourselves. The other thing to ask you was, what did you think of Brendan going to a back five?
I thought that change was a good one. I wasn't particularly pleased with his work as well as the players earlier on in the match. The change he made at half time didn't really work either, because he went to a diamond in the second half.
Mm-hmm.
But the switch to the back five just gave us, you know, a coherent plan. It was, we are sitting in and we're going to defend this lead for all we can. And it wasn't the most inventive, but it was a set. This is what we are doing. Here's the shape. Just do it. And it was simple. And it worked, because it killed the game. They weren't really able to create anything.
Yeah, talking to the back five, Janko got a lot of criticism from people after the game. How did you see his performance when you were watching it in the cold light of day, knowing the result?
I don't think it was as bad as, you know, when I'd heard a bit about what people were saying about Janko, and I was thinking he'd had an absolute nightmare and he's just been torn apart. I think really what it came down to was that he gave away a penalty, and obviously there was the incident for their second goal, and from that people have just said, oh, he's had a bad game, and he's maybe not had a great game, but it wasn't the catastrophe that I was expecting to see, having heard people's opinions from the game before I'd seen the game.
So you didn't think he was that bad? One other question I've got, whilst I've got my technical guy on, in terms of us being crap at set pieces and corners and whatever, I know Brendan's done it once, and I remember Mourinho doing it a couple of times. Why don't we then have more people at the halfway line when we're defending a corner? Because the opposition's always going to have at least one more guy than we've got. So if we put three up, they're going to have four back. And it'll just declutter. If part of our problem, it would just declutter the penalty box, because there'd be seven players not in it.
Yeah. I remember, I think it was Johan Cruyff that actually said, when he managed Barcelona, and he said, my team was tiny, but I just left three or four guys up the pitch every time. And they ended up just putting their defenders back there, because after, generally, when teams leave their players back, it's generally fullbacks, the smallest midfielder.
Yeah, I mean, for instance, we had, with a full strength team, Roberts on one side, Sinclair on the other, Griffiths on the halfway line at the right at the centre spot, and then maybe even somebody else at the edge of the centre circle. You know, if you had four back, they're not going to go. Any team's not going to go man for man. They're going to have an extra body on that. So they then stick five back. I know it would take a lot of balls, but I'm just trying to come up with thought processes about how you counter the fact that we are crap at defending a corner.
Yeah. That would be especially good if we had a keeper who was dominant, because all that space, you know, if you clear out nine players from the box, effectively four from ours and five of theirs, or yeah, four and four, then there's a lot more space for the goalkeeper. So if we had a goalkeeper that was particularly good, even for an average goalkeeper like Gordon, in that regard, that would be a help to him. But you can imagine, for a team that had an excellent keeper coming out and collecting crosses, that would be an ideal strategy, because you're basically opening up the box for him. I suppose it's just one of these things where it's a risk reward thing, and it's more,
I can imagine the first time we lose a goal with four guys at the halfway line, I can imagine the manager that does that getting absolute pelters.
Yeah. Oh, definitely. Yeah. And it's like we were talking about before, with the kind of unusual ideas, and to leave three or four guys up is still an abnormal thing to do. And so anything that a coach does in that regard will get doubly scrutinised if a mistake's made. I think that maybe teams, see if you leave one guy up or two guys up and then the rest in the box, I think most managers, in fact, I almost think managers would be daft not to do it, because they're saving themselves any criticism, because if you leave one or two guys up, then no one's ever going to say, oh, why is he not? Why has he got so many guys up there, or why does he not get any guys up there? I always think the same thing with man marking, that in the culture with the media, and we know that the media can affect people's perceptions of managers, that even if I was someone who preferred a zonal system, I would play man marking because it would just make your job that bit easier. And I think that's what it comes down to, with leaving three or four guys up, that it's an easy option to not do that. But it's good to see that he's done it with three guys in the last couple of games.
Right, so that's talking about the game. We're now through, we're in the Champions League, and the group is Barcelona, Man City, Borussia Mönchengladbach, and the famous Glasgow Celtic. So 50% of the group have won the big cup.
That's a very fair point.
I had a bit of a disagreement with Tom English tonight, because you know that way, the problem with Twitter is it's 140 characters, and so you've only got a short period of time, and then an argument goes on, and you sort of get bored with it. It was only because on Radio Scotland, they were talking about it, and he said, Kenny McIntyre had asked a question. He said, I'm sure it's not the group that Brendan Rodgers would want, but it's the group that every Celtic fan would want. Oh, no, that was it. He was talking about getting Barcelona. I'm sure Brendan Rodgers wouldn't have wanted Barcelona, but every Celtic fan would have. And I'm sitting there thinking, well, I don't know about every Celtic fan, but I know every Celtic fan that I know was saying, you know, I love the Champions League and it'll be great whoever we get, but if there's one team I don't want to get, I just can't be bothered getting Barcelona again. Every single Celtic fan I know said that. So I then went on and tweeted and said, pity Tom and Richard Wilson don't know Celtic fans, because, or something along these lines, don't know Celtic fans because there's not a Celtic fan I know who did want Barcelona. And, you know, or he then takes it from, he then starts the from the premise of, I'm saying that I don't like, get, you know, that it's rubbish that we've got Barcelona. You know, it's no different to, I love an Indian meal, right? I love going for an Indian. And if my, and having a 6-year-old, you don't get out that much. So if we were, if my wife and I said, I've organised a babysitter tonight, do you fancy going to the Turban Tandoori? I would say, that's brilliant, that's magic. And then if next Friday she said to me, do you know what, organise the babysitter again, fancy going to the Turban again? I'd say, yeah, that's brilliant, that's magic. See, we then skipped it for a month, and then she said, a month later, I'm going out for a meal, going for the Turban again. Oh, that's good. See, if the following week she said, going for a meal, organise the Turban, I'd be like, can we go for a Chinese? Or can we go for an Italian? It's not to say I don't like going for an Indian. I still think an Indian's brilliant, and I'm still absolutely chuffed that I'm going out on a Friday night. But you know what? The last few times I've had an Italian, I've had an Indian, it'd be quite nice to have something different. Do you get my point? I'm not chuffed to bits that we're playing Champions League, and I'm not saying I'm not chuffed to bits that we're getting Barcelona, but since the last time we played Real Madrid, I was 9. I was sitting thinking, maybe we could get Real Madrid.
That was, I mean,
you're younger than me, so you've never had Real Madrid in your lifetime.
No, I haven't. I don't know if you saw, but last night, and everyone was saying, you know, once obviously all the ties finished and people are saying, oh, I fancy this group and I like this combination of teams. And the only thing I tweeted about it was that I'm not really someone who'll sit and say, oh, I want X, Y, and Z teams, but can we not have Barcelona? That was my tweet was, only one request, not Barcelona. And it was for exactly that reason. It's not that I don't have any interest in, it wasn't that they're a good team, and so I don't want a good team, because ultimately you're in the competition to play good teams. If I don't want to play good teams, I would have been happy if we'd lost on Tuesday night. It's not that seeing guys like Neymar, Suarez and Messi, arguably the best front three ever, isn't an amazing thing to see. It's that I've seen Messi more than once. I've seen Barcelona. It's something different. And especially for the guys that travel, it's another trip. You know, how many, say if you're a Celtic fan, say anywhere between the age of 30 to 50, you will have seen Barcelona more times than you'll have seen your wife in the last 10 years. I started to think, even 15 years, I saw, what was it? The one that I got tonight was, in the last seven times Celtic have been in the Champions League, they've played Barcelona five.
It's four.
Is it four?
In the last seven times Celtic have been in the Champions League, they've played Barcelona. Well, obviously they played them, they've drawn them on four occasions, so they played them eight times.
Yeah, eight times, yeah. So there you go. So, I mean, like I say, it's not that being in the competition and playing good teams or playing a team like Barcelona isn't great. It's that we've kind of done Barcelona, and it's not, you know, we're not, if we're going to get a team like that, we're not really looking for who can we get a result against. It's more about the glamour of the game and all that, and Celtic Barcelona is just something we've seen before.
Yeah, as you say, I'm not, it then started going down, you know, when, you know, actually the thing that got me was, my whole point was, because Tom English then eventually got round saying, so do you speak for every Celtic fan? Well, I never did, said I did. He did. He was the one who said, this will be the game that all Celtic fans would want. And all I said was, well, not the Celtic fans I know. You know, because a guy then, the thing that got me was the amount of people who then tweeted saying, I agree. I don't want them again. And then one person tweeted me saying, well, if you don't want them, I'll have your ticket. I'm not saying I don't want them. I mean, I don't think it's that sophisticated an argument, which is, it's a, again, using my food analogy, another argument is, say you go to your favourite restaurant, every time you go, there's eight things on the menu that you think, I could eat any of them. But my top three favourite ones would be, and there's three of them. Every single time you went to that restaurant, you wouldn't have the same meal. Or if you had it the first three times you went, you might think, but you know what? I know I really like that, but I've always fancied their XYZ on the menu, and I'll try that. And if the chef then came along and said, no, you've got to have the thing you've always had, you might go, oh, do you know, for once, I just fancy the other thing.
Yeah, it's just as simple as you've got nice options. You know, you're in the Champions League, so every team you can get is a nice draw because it's about being in the Champions League. And if you get a big team, then great, it's a glamour tie. If you get maybe an easier team, then that gives you a better chance of winning. So everything's a kind of, it's not that you do not want any of the teams. It's just that I would kind of prefer this. I like a bit of variety. I've seen Barcelona. You know, you're saying you were nine whenever we played Real Madrid. So you're whatever age you are.
46.
There
it was in season 79-80, so it was like four months before my 10th birthday.
Yeah, so there you go. So you have had pretty much double the experience of watching Celtic that I have. You've seen more teams and you're sick of Barcelona. All I seem to remember from Celtic playing in Europe is Barcelona. The earliest games I can really remember, Barcelona in the UEFA Cup. I mean, if I think back to what the first games I really remember clearly is the UEFA Cup final. But from then on, that's 12 years ago. We have played Barcelona time and again, UEFA Cup.
Well, since then, we played them in the UEFA Cup the following round. I was at both games. The one thing I remember was there was a big thing on the scoreboard about how Barcelona were back. They must have, and they were going to get to the UEFA Cup final. I mean, the whole thing was they were going to get to UEFA Cup final, and obviously we then beat them. And then the following year, we got them again in the Champions League, where we lost 3-1 at home, where Henrik scored.
Yep.
And then managed to get the one each away where Hartson scored. Then season 2007-08 was when we lost 3-2 at Celtic Park where Barry Robson scored.
Yeah, and Henri,
yep,
I'm sure, scored for them because that was when they had Messi and Ronaldinho in the same team that night.
And then we lost 1-0 in the Nou Camp. And then there was season 2012-13, where we lost 2-1 there, and was it Samaras that scored to put us one up?
Yeah.
And then that's right, and they scored the winner.
In the last minute, Jordi Alba scored in the 91st minute or something.
And Effie Ambrose was immense that night with Kelvin Wilson.
Yeah. Oh, for that whole campaign, well, for that whole group stage. Here's a kind of a bit of trivia in that regard, is that the night that we beat Barcelona at Celtic Park, when Tony Watt scored, was the first European win I ever seen live at Celtic Park.
Is that right? We win all the time at Celtic Park.
Yeah. Well, I think we've like qualifying games and stuff like that.
Do you know what? You are a jinx, because I was just thinking, I arranged for you to be on the first podcast that you were on. I arranged it in advance to talk about the Red Imps game.
Yeah.
And we get beat. And then I organised it in advance for you to be on tonight for us to discuss the Champions League draw. And I'm, at one point I was thinking, Jack's a bloody jinx. We're going to lose this. And I've organised for him to be on Thursday night just to discuss the draw.
Yeah. Oh, it was. Yeah. Maybe you're right. Maybe I'm just a bit cursed. Yeah. But just the way that it went, and when I started going to games regularly, and I'd been to games before that, but that was the first. That was the first group stage game I'd seen us win, because I'd been to Champions League games before, but we'd never won. And then I'd been to Europa League games, but we'd never won. And that was the first proper tournament win I'd ever witnessed.
Wow.
So, yeah, I'm sick of Barcelona. I'm sick of Barcelona.
Yeah, I mean, as I say, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying, oh, I'm just, all I was trying to get across was, Tom English said it's the game that all Celtic fans wanted, and actually all the Celtic fans that I knew were saying, do you know what, see if we could get it. Whoever we get at the top, whoever we get would be brilliant. My preference would be we don't get Barcelona. However, having just talked about the fact we play Barcelona all the time, I've just checked on Soccer Base just to make sure my recollections are correct. We have played neither Man City nor Borussia Mönchengladbach in a competitive game ever.
Ever? There you go. I'd known that we hadn't played them in any time recently. I'm thinking that we might have played Gladbach, but obviously, sort of 30 or so years ago, they were quite big in Europe. But obviously,
and in the '70s, they were Borussia Mönchengladbach were the big German team in the '70s. Growing up, I mean, they might not have been the whole earlier the '70s. You know, you're still in Bayern Munich, but you know what it's like as a child? Anything that happened in the last 18 months have been going on forever. My recollection of the '70s. As it was Borussia Mönchengladbach. I mean, they lost to Liverpool in the 77 European Cup final.
Yeah.
So that's the first European Cup final I can really vividly remember. I can actually remember being out in the back garden and my mum coming in and saying, that's the football about to start, and going in to watch that. So that was just before my seventh birthday. So that's the first one I can really, really remember.
Yeah, so, and obviously Manchester City don't have necessarily a grand European history, so I didn't expect that we'd played them. So yeah, maybe that's a little bit of variety that we're not getting from the Barcelona tie.
No, and something that will entertain Saint is we'll end up wearing our pink strip for certain when we play
Mönchengladbach. Yeah,
because their first strip is more or less black and white hoops. Their second strip is all green. So we can't play, certainly if when they play at home, we can't play with the hoops, and we can't play in all black.
No.
So we'll definitely be wearing the pink.
Yeah, you knew it would get a run out anyway at some point this season, because that always seems to be the way with the kits, that they have to get at least a game. A big game.
I'm sure UEFA have the same type of rule the English have about not liking teams to wear the same colour shorts. So a lot of the time when we play a team away from home, we have to change kit because we'll never do any. You know how like Man U change, sometimes wear red top black shorts and red top white shorts?
Yeah.
Whereas we'll never wear anything other than green and white hoops and white shorts.
Yeah.
And I think as a consequence of that, I think, somebody listening will know better than me, I think UEFA don't like same coloured shorts of teams. So when we play a team whose home strip's white shorts, we will automatically have to change.
Yeah, it could be that way. So yeah, certainly, as much as, and we'll get on to talking about the group, it's just about as hard a group as we could have gotten. But we can't really sit and complain and say, oh, you know, tough group, because as I said before, if we didn't want a tough group, then we're in the wrong competition at the end of the day.
There is a part of me actually, you know, without wishing my life away, but there's a part of me thinking, right, okay, you can't change a team it's costly to change a whole team in one transfer window. So if we can get another couple of players in this summer transfer window, that's done. Don't humiliate ourselves in this Champions League group. Maybe get another player or two in at Christmas. Then next summer, get another player or two in. It's maybe actually after the squad has had one round of Champions League football and we've had another two transfer windows. It's maybe next year's Champions League that we should be aiming for. This is the Champions League where we're going to see if we can finish second.
Yeah. Yeah, that's it. Maybe the squad just now, even in an easier group, would still have a tough time. And I think even if we did improve the team, any group in the Champions League, it's going to be tough to qualify from there. Even because I was like, as the draw was coming out, and I thought, when you know you get to the point where all the pot three teams have all come out, so you've got these sort of groups of three teams, and you're thinking Celtic are either going to play one of these three groups of three teams even. And there was one, it was Leicester, Porto, Bruges, and I'm thinking, that's the easy group.
That's the group where, I'm not saying we would have beaten them all, but that's the group where if we were ever going to have a chance of battling to stay in the Champions League beyond Christmas, that was the group. I think Leicester will finish 12th or 13th this season.
Yeah, I mean, we'll see how they adapt to what they've done. I mean, ultimately, they won't do half as well as they did last year. I would be a bit more optimistic for them than you've been there, but not any more than, you know, they're not going to break that top six for sure. They'll be in there, I would imagine, with the Southamptons and the West Hams this year. I think they've still got a very decent team, very good team, but when you look at that pot one, and you've got Real Madrid, Barcelona, Juventus, PSG, Bayern Munich, Benfica even, Leicester or CSK Moscow, we'll take that.
Yeah. So, we've got, how many days left? I need my glasses on to look at the date in the watch. We've got some days left in the transfer window.
About a week,
right? And I keep hearing that it's two players in. I noticed Peter Lawwell tonight said one player in, but I'm hoping that that's under promise over deliver stuff. I also just as we started recording, read somebody saying that Stefan Johansson's at Fulham for a medical tonight, which would make sense because he's patently nowhere near the team under Brendan Rodgers. I mean, I personally would have had Johansson in the team or at least come on in the game in midweek. Certainly the Johansson of a season and a half ago I would have had come on. But anyway, he's patently out of the picture. Whether it's one player or two players, I also keep hearing that whatever it's one or two, at least one person that we are talking to would only come if we were playing Champions League football. So what position if we were only getting one, what position would you go for?
I think this wouldn't be a particularly controversial opinion, but it's going to have to be a midfielder. I think what we've got there is all quite decent, but we've got, in terms of, if you look at the overall picture of the rest of the team, first of all, we're fairly well set in goals and in defence. And in terms of up towards the top of the team, we've got sort of five really good options for the front three positions in Griffiths, Dembele, Forrest, Roberts and Sinclair. Or Sinclair, as you and Martin discussed last week.
Yeah, Sinclair. It's like his first name's Scott.
So
it's Scott Sinclair. It's well, easy to tell him, take him aside.
Yeah.
Although, did you notice in the Scotland under 20 squad, there's a guy called Harvey Sinclair?
I didn't see that, no.
No, he's plays for Chelsea. Signed for Chelsea at 8.
Oh, dear. Yeah, so.
For the older people, as in Isla Sinclair. Anyway, carry on.
There you go. Yeah, so in the front, attacking positions were kind of set. We're set in central defence, I think, well. Left back, yeah. Maybe right back is a sort of second choice for position that needs upgraded, but I would say a midfielder, especially with how awfully we kept the ball on Tuesday night. That just exaggerated the issue. I think Rodic is a very good player, but when you're playing against Barcelona, Tom Rodic is not going to give you the defensive work you need, not even close. Or Man City for that matter. Or now that I think of it, and the team that they've got, Borussia Mönchengladbach, none of those games are really going to be suitable for Tom.
The quicker way to have done that would have been to have just said Tom Rodic's not suited for the Champions League.
Yeah, seems a bit harsh, but now that I think about who we've got, that's, yeah, it's going to be tough for him. I think obviously we've been linked to McCarthy. The thing for me is that, and I think Roger said it tonight, actually, he said something along the lines of, we need a creative midfielder.
So here's the names. Tell me if any of these would fit your bill. Here's the names that I have heard, and I'm not attributing saying that one's more than another, or one's likely, or I'm just telling you the names that I have heard in the last 48 hours as potentials. McCarthy, Xavi, Schweinsteiger, Carrick.
McCarthy.
$72,000 a week, McCarthy. Is that who you're going for?
Oh, really? Really? Is that?
That's who he's on at Everton.
Dear me. I don't imagine that's what he'd be on here, but if they can convince him, then, you know. I think what you've got there is three excellent players at their peak, but Schweinsteiger is famously always injured.
And as I say, some of these could be, they've got as much chance as you and I of.
Yeah, it could be, but just from those names, Schweinsteiger, injury prone, Xavi must be approaching 40.
35.
There we go.
Ancient.
And again, if he was looking for a challenge, I'm not quite sure he would have went to Qatar. When he left Barcelona, I'm sure he had plenty of other offers. And then Carrick, again, probably the more likely of the three kind of older big names that you mentioned there. I think the thing with all of those guys is that I wouldn't really class any of them as a creative midfielder. McCarthy being the most likely one, but the problem is that if you imagine, if we have a midfield three this season, and we spoke about Rodic maybe not going to fit the bill, you would imagine that if, compared to the team on Tuesday, if we sign a midfielder, the guy that will lose out will be McGregor.
Yeah.
But if you sign McCarthy, McCarthy is kind of similar to Brown and Beaton, not necessarily in style, but in their positional. They're somewhere between a deep holding midfielder and a kind of not necessarily attacking but not defensive, kind of in between. If you use the sort of old numbering system, they're somewhere between a 6 and an 8. And that means we've got no real attacking threat. Brown is probably then your most attacking central midfielder, and I'm not certain that that's the kind of balance that we need. So maybe with Rodgers saying a creative player, that maybe it's something different to those names that we've mentioned. And I would probably say personally that would be my preference.
So if you were to pick any player that you thought was within Celtic's budget, who would you go for?
Oh, dear, I can't stand this question.
I'm sorry.
No, it's just you get asked this question a lot, and unless you're one of the top sort of six or seven teams in the world, then I tend to think the answer is probably someone you've never heard of. The best option is probably someone you've never heard of.
Yeah.
If I was to at least give you a profile, then it would be something between a number 10 and a passing midfielder, which Callum McGregor kind of is. So I'm going to say just a better version of Callum McGregor. That's I would like that. I think good decent dribbling skills. He's a good passer, but McGregor's just not quite at the level. So someone a bit more, you know, an upgrade basically on that style of player would be ideal, I think.
Okay, so then the next thing is, what's your predictions for how we're going to do?
Oh dear. I would be very pleased if we managed to get 5 points. That would be really good performance, because in honesty, what I'm expecting is 2 comfortable defeats from Barcelona. Particularly playing Manchester City in December away.
That's an interesting one, because I mean, depending, you never know. You never know. But there's a good chance that Barcelona and Man City are both through. So they're through at that game. And we might be playing that game to have a chance of finishing third.
It could be. But I think, especially with the fact that Guardiola is just in the door and things maybe aren't necessarily, you know, all singing, all dancing for them just yet, that they might have a slowish start, and then maybe Munchengladbach could take something from them in the kind of first three, the opening three games, that I don't imagine they will have. Barcelona probably will have, but I don't imagine they will have taken themselves through by that last game. And so what you're going to have is Guardiola with 6 months behind him, playing a game that he might need to win. Because if Barcelona are through, then they'll probably do that thing that they did when we got to the last 16, which is play a terrible team in the last game, you know, a youth team.
Uh-huh.
And then we had to rely on the youth team getting a result for us to make the last 16. So that would mean that if it's between Manchester City and Mönchengladbach for second place, then Manchester City might need to win that game. So I wouldn't be confident about that one. I think as much as Mönchengladbach are a good team, a very good team, that obviously they're the team that we can get the most from, and maybe Manchester City at home as well. So those would be the 3 games that I would look at and say, yeah, that's where we need to get something.
So 5 points, we are going to beat the Germans at home, draw with Man City, that's 4 points.
And then a draw away in Germany.
Whoa. I know. So we're going to beat the we're finishing third under that system, because we're going to beat the Germans on the head-to-head.
That's what happens when I try to be an optimist. It's just not... ultimately, I think the group will pan out exactly in the way that the teams come out of the pots. I think that order will be the order the group finishes in. I think each team is just slightly too strong for the one above. Barcelona are just a bit too good for Man City. Man City for Gladbach, and Gladbach for us. Generally, you'll get a result that you wouldn't have expected. So maybe our best result will be away to Manchester City or something like that. But it's a huge ask even to just make third in that group. We've got one of the better teams in pot 3. We've got, again, one of the better teams in pot 2, and we've got the best team in Europe. When they drew the pot 1, 2, and 3, and then you looked and you saw the teams and you're thinking, one of these trios, that's who we are going to get. That was the hardest one. That was the hardest one we could have gotten. And so it's a huge task, but...
But this is Celtic.
Yeah.
Anything's possible with Celtic.
Yeah. Just wait until 3 weeks' time when we're in the new camp and I'm sitting there going, yeah, we could get a result here.
We can get a result. We have done it before and we will do it again.
It's that typical Celtic thing of, just being absolutely frightened that you're going to lose at home to Astana, but then believing that you'll easily get a result away to some of the best teams in Europe. Like,
right, so the other way of looking at it is we go to the new camp, you know, we're really starting to fly under Brendan Rodgers. I mean, obviously the dilemma he would have would be whether to rest people in the game before we go to the new camp. We're playing a newly promoted side, so he might decide to maybe play a second string in the Saturday before we go to the new camp.
That would probably be a wise choice, I think. When you look at the balance, especially with the game being on the Tuesday, a kind of run-of-the-mill league game where you're expecting us to take the 3 points quite easily, it would probably be wise to give some of the...
I mean, I suppose his other option is maybe, you know, if we are, say, 4 or 5 up with about 15, 20 minutes to go, then he can take off, obviously, 3 key players. So there's that. We go to the new camp and it's, what, 3-3 in the new camp. So then we come back to Celtic Park and play Man City. They'll have their new keeper in. He'll be unnerved, so we take 3 off them. Our defence is getting better by then, so that's 3-0. So that's us on 4 points after 2 games.
That's a good start.
Then we've got the Germans, and obviously that'll be a tricky one. They'll be coming, you know, from the 1970s with a long hair and moustaches and beards and sideburns, and they come to Celtic Park, and... Or are we away first and then at home? Or no, we're at home.
No, home first.
We're at home, that's right, because we're away, home, away, home, or whatever it is. Anyway, so yes, so we play them and take 2-0 against them. In fact, is that the order? Is it Barcelona, Man City, Borussia, Munchengladbach, Borussia, Munchengladbach? No, it can't be that.
No, it's away to Barca, and then 2 home games, Man City and Borussia, and then away to Borussia, home to Barca.
That's it. Right,
and then
so
away to City in the last
home
game.
To Man City, we've beaten them 2-0, Borussia, Mönchengladbach. Then we're away, that's a tricky one. Maybe 1 each.
Take a point over there.
So that's us on 8, yep. Then we are away to Man City.
Home to Barcelona.
Home to Barcelona. 1 each.
Yeah, as long as Christian Wolf pointed out on Twitter earlier on, as long as we get chips for the players before that game, then we should be able to get maybe even a win.
Yeah. Well, maybe Jenk a win.
Oh, well, you know, we've done it on chips before.
No, I think it may just be a draw. So that's 9 points. So then we go down to Main Road. And I know it's not Main Road. So we go down the Main Road and we're on 9 points. So it's really how well Man City have done in their section as to whether they're looking to battle for us for.
And obviously they'll have to deal with the return of Dedrick Boyata to his first team, which is a big thing for them, obviously.
That's right. Well, we'll be playing with Dedrick Boyata and Patrick Roberts.
Yeah. Oh, and it's actually... we haven't even mentioned this, that it's an excellent chance for Messi to meet his hero, Patrick Roberts.
Correct, yes. So, there we are, 9 points going into the last game.
Yeah, but, you know, I mean, it's not what I would hope for, but I would take it at this point.
Yep. And then it's all up for grabs.
Yep.
Because if we can finish top of that group, I guess there's an excellent chance of getting to Cardiff.
Yeah. Exactly. You're exactly right. I don't know what I was thinking with 5.
Exactly. You're 50% out. You were at 5 after just a couple of games. That's where you were just kidding me on.
Yep. Yeah. No. Now that you've sort of went through it like that, I can definitely see that it should be fairly straightforward for us, really.
Exactly. So that's the Champions League group stage is done. Final thing for the podcast that we've got. We're playing our title challengers on Saturday.
Oh, of course, the second best team in Scotland, Aberdeen.
Yes. How's that going to go?
I would imagine it would go well. Players will be tired and such, but on the high of qualifying, I'd imagine that, like most teams, in fact, like all teams in Scotland, they won't quite be good enough to match us. And I'll say 3-1.
Do you know, I was thinking about, the players got back about 5 o'clock or something like that on Wednesday night. Right, so we played Tuesday. The players get back 5 o'clock Wednesday night. So I can imagine they might have had the day off today.
Yeah,
they might have been. You know, anybody who's got, you know, or maybe come in for just an hour session or something, because you've got to have a day off in the week. Really, we've only got Friday for the manager to have any preparation to discuss how Aberdeen might play.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
With the players.
Yeah, that's Europe for you. And I was thinking, when we were talking about the game that we have before the Champions League opener, and I thought it was odd that that's been played on the Saturday rather than the Sunday, especially because it clashes with the Manchester Derby.
Yeah, but it's to do, there's a cycle race in Glasgow on the Sunday, and I think Duke Street's closed.
Oh, really? Well, there you go. That's maybe just fortunate then for us, because I was thinking we are now to play on the Sunday when we're away to Barcelona on the Tuesday seems a bit ridiculous.
I think we would have.
So the Saturday would, you know, it turns out it's made sense, whether that was the intention behind it or not.
I think we would have been in our rights to. I mean, to cause a problem for TV, but I can't see how we would have put up with playing Sunday and Tuesday.
I think it's a kind of standard thing. Whenever you see, obviously Sky's big English thing is a sort of Super Sunday.
Yeah.
And whenever it's before a European week, Super Sunday's almost always awful.
Yeah.
It's usually like Bournemouth against Stoke or something like that.
It doesn't stop them telling you that it's the greatest game the world's ever known, though.
Well, it is, obviously. I mean, who doesn't want to see Bournemouth, Stoke? But, yeah, so I think generally teams that are playing in Europe don't get Sunday games. So, Aye. Yeah.
Anyway, that's us. I will try and pull this together. I do notice Celtic View have managed to get a podcast out already on the back of the draw. I think they got it at about 7 o'clock, so they were really on the ball. I think at By The Min have got a podcast out. I think it's a few people's ideas to have podcasts out. So whoever's listening to this, you'll have your a plethora of Celtic podcasts to choose from discussing the Champions League draw. I wonder if we'll all be saying the same.
I think people will just have been, I mean, obviously, even if this is the third one out, people are happy to wait for the quality.
Obviously, yes, quality before quantity. Well put, Jack. You've only been on three and you're already in. You know your stuff.
Yeah, well, of course. How could you not know that, and how could you not appreciate the longest running football fans podcast?
Exactly. Although, there was something you just did there, Jack. I'm a bit suspicious. You sounded like Grant Russell from STV there. Just the way you said something. I'm suspicious that secretly Grant's not a Livingston fan.
I'm sure Grant wouldn't be too offended by that. I'll hope.
Okay, anyway, I will say here's hoping for that 9 points going in the last game that I talked about. I think we'll all be walking on air if that's the case. Anyway, I'll see. Thanks very much, Jack.
Thanks again.
Guest with Young Jack. We have a few things going on. Remember, if you want your new music on, this podcast is the exception for the bits you'll have seen at the, listened to the beginning. podcast at CelticUnderground.net if you want your Celtic story on. We've got a couple coming up. It is podcast at CelticUnderground.net. Celtic FC Foundation have got a number of things coming for the new season. There is the Foundation Sleepout in November. There'll obviously be the Christmas collection in December. There is the Girls for Good in December. And if you're taking part in the Glasgow Half Marathon or any other fundraising event, you can contact the Celtic FC Foundation and you can raise funds for that. We didn't touch on the Palestinian flags and the fundraising for that. We were specifically talking about the football and the Champions League. So obviously Celtic will have the UEFA decision towards the end of next month, and I'm sure we will discuss the flags and the fundraising being done by the Celtic supporters for Palestine. I note St Etienne fans tonight, or even the Palestinian flags. And personal opinion is that if you somebody actually took UEFA to court, it would last a very short time in a court of law. UEFA's position being untenable based on some of the contradictory things that they do, but it's UEFA, and that's for another day. Anyway, enough of me. Hope you enjoyed the podcast. We've got Aberdeen on Saturday, as we say in the podcast. If you were wanting to get in some recommendation for podcasts, it's podcast at CelticUnderground.net. A couple of recommendations came in for election ones, because I'd mentioned political stuff last week, specifically the Off Message podcast, if you're interested in American politics coming up. Guardian Politics Weekly, because obviously there's also, as people have recommended, the Guardian's Football Weekly. And there is also the Cambridge Politics podcast, which is an intermittent thing. They covered the UK election and the Brexit, and I think they'll be covering the American election as well. Experts from Cambridge University on that. There'll be more podcasts along. I think next podcast I will specifically focus on other Celtic podcasts. I know they might not be as good as this one, but you might know, you might want to listen to them. Anyway, enough of me. We're in the Champions League. Hail, hail. This is me, Harry Brady. That was him, Jack Lyons, saying God bless and good night. Good night. To fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, to love pure and chaste from afar, to try when your arms are too weary, the unreachable star. This is my quest, to follow that star. No matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right, without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know, and calm when I'm laid to my rest, and the world will be better for this, that one man is scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage to find